Consider your ways, part two. In Consider Your Ways, part one, we noted that one of the things that deceive Christians into thinking that they are alive when they are actually dead, or that they are rich when in fact they are poor, is paying undue attention to praise singers, whether they are sincere or hypocritical. We discussed some of the ways we should handle the praises of men, and also why we all need to allow God to constantly examine and tell us how we are doing in our Christian race. Another thing that makes some Christians fail to recognize that they are dead or poor is when signs and wonders still follow their ministry. We all need to understand that it is possible to still operate as a servant of God even when one is no longer walking on the straight and narrow path that leads to eternal life. The case of Judas Iscariot should serve as a warning to us all. According to John chapter 12 verse 6, Judas was a thief. However, he probably never saw any need to cry out for help concerning his weakness, because Jesus did not just keep him at the level of the great multitude that followed him, neither did he limit him to the level of the 70, but allowed him to be named among the 12 disciples. Jesus did not leave Judas out when he did what was reported in Matthew chapter 10 verse 1. And when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Judas also received power, and demons were subject unto him because of Jesus. The fact that Judas was a thief did not stop the Lord from making him the minister for finance in his cabinet. But when the time came, all the positions he held in the Lord's service, all the outings he had with Jesus and the other disciples, all the havoc he wreaked against Satan and his demons did not stop him from going the way of destruction, and another person took over his position, and the Lord's work continued. Acts chapter 1 verses 20 to 26. No matter how well you seem to be doing in your ministry, you need to deal with every sin that easily besets you, because God is not a respecter of persons, and so will never lower his standard to accommodate you just because you are busy for him. Are you one of those pastors who visit pornographic sites and still go on to stand and minister to God's people? Do you hide hatred with a lying tongue and still go to stand to minister to others? Be not deceived by the fact that God still moves in the congregation of his people. He is by no means endorsing your dirty heart and life. He is only honoring his word and the faith of his people. Your seeming success in the ministry notwithstanding, Numbers chapter 32 verse 23 still says, "Be sure your sin will find you out. It's just a matter of time." Finally, one other entity that can make a dead Christian to think that he's alive, or a poor Christian to see himself as rich, is the Christian himself. Some compare themselves to others and manage to convince themselves that they are better than everyone else. How do you know that you are a better Christian than the next person? Just as you do not know your own heart, so also you do not know the people around you or how God is dealing with them. And by the way, Christianity is an individual race. You need to face your own race and run it well for yourself, and stop giving yourself a pat on the back just because you think you are at least better than your neighbor, when actually God is not happy with you. Some Christians deceive themselves by always noticing what is wrong with others, but not what is wrong with their own lives. We all need to always remember Luke chapter 23, verses 26 to 28. "And as they led him away, they laid hold upon one Simon, a Cyrenian, coming out of the country. And on him they laid the cross, that he might bear it after Jesus. And there followed him a great company of people and of women, which also bewailed and lamented him. But Jesus, turning unto them, said, Daughters of Jerusalem, weep not for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children." It is very interesting to hear some servants of God bless members of their congregation at the end of a Sunday service, for instance. Some say things like, "This week as you go, the Lord will go with you. The Lord will keep you from committing sin. Pastor, don't you also need the Lord to keep you from committing sin? Or have you arrived already and so don't need help like the rest of us?" Instead of standing there like a spiritual giant praying for God's helpless children, why don't you humble yourself and pray for everyone, including yourself? Do not forget 1 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 12, "Wherefore let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall." Some Christians also gossip about, or some sincerely pray for others that have fallen into sin. You have no right to gossip about the sin or weakness of anyone, but rather the Bible enjoins us to pray for one another. However, whether you choose to gossip or to pray, you need to consider your own sins, which may be hidden to all but you and the all-knowing God. Weep for yourself as well. Some Christians deceive themselves into thinking that all is well by failing to take a sincere, honest look at themselves in the light of God's word and the witness of the Holy Spirit, while some are just nonchalant. Some even believe that somehow they will find themselves in heaven without having to play any part at all towards getting there. Such Christians seem to forget that each of us is expected to work out his or her own salvation with fear and trembling, according to Philippians chapter 2, verse 12. Finally, there are Christians who are wise in their own conceit, and so even when people who genuinely love and care for them see something that needs to be corrected in them and try to point it out, they take offense and stop relating with such people. If you are in this category, Proverbs chapter 26, verse 12 has something for you to think about. Fear thou a man wise in his own conceit, there is more hope of a fool than of him. Don't let fools be better than you. Ask God to make you teachable and corrigible. How is your Christian life? May the Lord help us in Jesus' name. Amen.